Hare Krishna, everyone, and massive thank you to each and every one of you for coming today. We really do appreciate your presence here. I know all of you guys have got very, very busy university, career, and school schedules, any youngsters, I don't know. So thank you so much for coming. And a special thanks to those of you who went to our Radha Deshmukh's retreat over the weekend. I know it was very, very tiring. You still managed to come here, so thank you. Now, as you guys have realised, we've got a very, very special guest with us today. When I first heard that we're going to have His Holiness Jayadvaita Swami with us, I was very, very happy, very excited, because I knew that for a period of 7 years, Maharaj was the editor-in-chief of the Bhakti Godhead magazine. Now, for those of you that don't know, the Bhakti Godhead magazine at the moment comes out every other month or so. And inside, there are lots of wonderful topics speaking about how Krishna consciousness is very relevant today and how we can apply it in our lives. Lots of wealth of information over there, so if you guys want any more information about Bhakti Godhead, do let me know. But the reason why I'm mentioning it is because one of the reasons why I'm here today is because of that magazine. And it's genuinely inspired me to take that step further in our spiritual life. So, thank you. So, Maharaj is a disciple of His Holiness, of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. And at age of 19, in 1968, Maharaj took initiation from Prabhupada. And 10 years later, Maharaj entered the renounced order of life called Sannyas. And Maharaj was involved extensively in editing and transcribing and putting manuscripts together of all the wonderful books that we know and love, like the Bhagavad-Gita and Krishna Upanishad by Srila Prabhupada. And Maharaj has been practicing Krishna consciousness for well over 40, 45 years. And in that long time period, he's spread the message of love, that combining Krishna consciousness all over the world, in countries like Argentina, Nigeria, and at the moment he's preaching extensively in Africa. And interviewing Maharaj today, we have Vinay, who's, I think many of you know him very well. If any of you have read his blog, called Levitate Blog, you'll know that he's a very, very good writer. So Vinay will be interviewing Maharaj today. And so as you can see, Maharaj has written a book, his first book, called Vanity Karma. And it's a cross-cultural commentary between Ecclesiastes in the Bible and the Bhagavad-Gita. So without further ado, let's warmly welcome, with a heart bursting with gratitude, our special guest.
So, how's everyone doing? Yeah, good. Can you just put your hands up let's make some noise if you're from City University. Okay. Makes sense, as we're in City University. Put your hands up if you're from Queen Mary's University. Okay. And make some noise if you're from King's. It's dying down. Make some noise if you're from anywhere else. We won't ask, okay. So I want to welcome you to this interview. As Rishi kindly said, Jayadvaita Swami has written his first book called Vanity Karma. And the style of this interview, what we're going to do, we're going to ask a few questions. If any of you from the audience feel that you also have a burning question from the conversation, feel free to stick up your hand. And then we can see if we can facilitate it in the conversation. It's actually all about you today, what you want to know about the book, and how we can inspire this conversation to go further. So just to start it off, I want to thank you for coming here today and being with us. I just wanted to ask, what does a young Jewish boy, how does a young Jewish boy from America get involved to become a monk of 40 years or so? So just a little about yourself.
Well, the idea of a monk is a little bit misleading. Maybe you think of a monk as someone off in a cloister somewhere, medieval sort of structure, and doing silence and so on. And that's not what I do. That I'm a monk means that I'm not involved in family life, no wife, no kids, none of that. And that my time is used for engagement with the service of Krishna. Krishna means the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And every one of us is a spiritual being and therefore has a relationship with Krishna. So to be a monk, as it were, means that I'm fully engaged in that sort of work without having to do studies or a job or that's other engagements. This is what I do full time.
So what does a monk do with their time?
Well, in the case of this monk, he does a lot with books. I was involved with, my earliest engagement was stapling booklets. And I graduated to typing, transcribing, proofreading, editing, managing book production. Now I oversee the work of our book trust in Africa. So there's a lot to do. We're not idle, and we're not just meditating, but there's practical activity. There's practical activity.
So to do this spiritual practical activity, do you have to be a monk? Because we normally, like the Dalai Lama or yourself.
No. The Bhagavad-Gita has spoken to Arjun, who's a married man, who's not at all a monk, he's a military man. And the message of Bhagavad-Gita concerns how one can perform one's work in divine consciousness or Krishna consciousness.
Okay, and so in your book, particularly Vanity Karma, you've, correct me if I'm wrong, you've taken the Bhagavad Gita, which you've so much experience in for the last 40 years, editing, helping transcribe your spiritual teacher's words, and you've mixed it with your own understanding of Ecclesiastes, is that correct?
Well, not exactly. What I do in Vanity Karma is I present the full text of Ecclesiastes, which is not really very long. It comes to about 12 pages all in all. And I comment on each verse. It's a running commentary. And I try to do two things in the commentary. First is just to speak to what the book is saying at face value. Or deeper than face value. What is it that the book says on its own intention? How have the Hebrew commentators understood the book, or how have modern commentators explicated the book on its own terms? On its own terms. Then what is it that we might bring to the book from the Bhagavad Gita? Because the first thing is, what is this book saying? It's not always clear. Then, how do we enter into dialogue with it from the point of view of Bhagavad Gita? What comparisons might we make, or what observations? How would a person who's a student of Bhagavad Gita read the book of Ecclesiastes? What light do the two books shine forth with, and how does that intersect, or what sort of dialogue does that result in?
Because that's interesting. For myself personally, I've heard of the Bhagavad Gita, coming from such a background, but just in this audience, put your hand up before this event if you've heard of Ecclesiastes as a book. So only a handful, which you kind of comment on in your introduction of the book, that people don't really know what Ecclesiastes says or what's his main message are. Even the person who's speaking in Ecclesiastes, I couldn't even pronounce his name.
Qohelet.
And it's a Q-O, right? And who sees that before? But so
Al-Qaeda.
I don't know what to say to that. But just for the benefit of myself and the audience, what are the main messages from Ecclesiastes, first of all?
The Ecclesiastes covers a lot of ground because it's a sort of introspective monologue, really, by the author. But his main opening shot is that life is meaningless. A cheery little thought for your day. His opening line, famously, is vanity of vanities, all is vanity. And by vanity, he doesn't mean pride or conceit, but he means a sense of meaninglessness, of uselessness, of emptiness. I acted in vain, my work was in vain. So he looks at the world and says that everything is in vain, everything is vanity. In Hebrew, the word is vapor. It's all vapor. So, and then he sets out to demonstrate why. It's not just a whine, but he puts forth his case for the meaninglessness of human life. And that puts him, of course, in difficulty. Now that my life is meaningless, what do I do? How do I deal with this? And he wanders, rather, and he tells of his attempt to find meaning, first in wealth. He says, I became a king and I became richer than all before me, and I built mansions, I planted vineyards, I had flocks of animals, I had women, I had gold, I had silver. And then I looked at it all and said, what's the use of it? I built all this up and I'll have to leave it to someone else who may just be a fool and squander it all. Why have I done this? What is the use? Then he says, well, let me try wisdom. He said, so I became wise, and I became wiser than all my predecessors. But as one commentator says, he became wiser than it was wise to be. Because he saw that wisdom also didn't amount to anything. He said, the wise man has his eyes in his head. Better to be wise than a fool, but the wise man and the fool both go to the same destination. They both die, they're both buried in the same graveyard, and what advantage does the wise man have over the fool? So he looks at wisdom also and says, ultimately wisdom is useless.
But that sounds quite, I don't know about you guys, but that sounds quite bleak.
It's totally bleak.
Because I like this excerpt from your book. It says, if I may, a man works his whole life, and what does he get for it? Generations come and go. The sun forever rises and sets. The wind blows about in circles, and the rivers endlessly pour into the sea. And for what? For nothing. Whatever has happened before will happen again. Whatever has been done before will be done again. And there is nothing new under the sun. The people who have lived before us have been forgotten, and we will be forgotten next. So whatever we do is in vain, pointless, a chasing after the wind. Now, to me, I kind of disagree with that point, because you see that there are so many new innovations in the world. For example, Steve Jobs with Apple. It's a massive innovation. It's a massive leap for productivity. Mark Zuckerberg with Facebook. It's a massive way to connect the world. And there's so many new discoveries to be found. So how can you say that everything is meaningless?
You buy an iPad and it allows you to do so many things, new things, like write. Or draw pictures. Or talk with other people.
But we can do it in style.
That's Kohelet's point, that you're doing the same thing again and again, and it's not really new. It's not really new. Previously they were shooting at people with revolvers, and now they've got automatic weapons. But you're doing the same thing. You're killing people. He says there's nothing new. There may be a new iteration, eating and sleeping 2.0, but it's eating and sleeping. What's new there? That's his challenge. That generations come and generations go. We all think we're contributing something new, we're doing something new, we're adding, we're building up, and it's all washed away by the waves of time. What is your new contribution? What have you made better? You know, you found a new remedy for this disease, and all your patients died anyway. What have you done? He's a powerful philosopher. He's not just a complainer. He makes his case strongly. There's nothing new. You think that you're under the illusion that you're doing something new, but you're doing the same thing that your predecessors did and that your successors will do. And your predecessors have been forgotten. Who was the mayor of London in 1912? He's forgotten. And whoever the mayor is now will be forgotten also. And his successors will be forgotten. That's his, as you say, very bleak case. He's not a feel-good philosopher. He's making a very strong point that we're working for nothing, that it's useless, that it, when you sum it all up, it doesn't add up to anything. Not a happy message. Not, of course, the message that I would end up with, but something very strong to contend with, something that can't just be easily dismissed. Oh, he's a complainer. Oh, he's bleak. He's negative. He has something very profound to say. And we need to, or we ought to, grapple with that. How does my life have meaning? I say my life has meaning. How does it?
First of all, I think Boris Johnson will be remembered, but just because of his haircut. But no, I see your point. And it is quite a bleak outlook, if you guys probably would agree. It's a bleak outlook on life because we hear so much about self-help and positivity. So if they say, but put your hands up. Just give me a shout. What would you guys say is the goal of life? Going quite deep on you right now. Just sum up in one word. Probably all of you come up with the same word. Goal of life is? To live. Okay, that's not what I was going for. That makes sense.
Happiness.
So if there's, would you guys agree? Yes or no? Yeah. So if the goal of life to most people is to be happy, and you're saying then life is meaningless, you can get the new iPad every year, and it's meaningless. It's vain. You can become the top professor in your field, the wisest of the wise, and it's all in vain. Then where do we kind of find happiness?
Let's start with where we don't find happiness. We don't find it where it's advertised. The idea is that, you know, if I eat better, if I sleep better, if my sex is better, then I'll be more happy. And first of all, it's a project that may fail. I may have bad digestion, bad sexual performance, sleep apnea. There's no guarantee that I'll be able to get what it is that I think is going to be fulfilling. Problem one. Problem two, if I get it, it's not what it's made out to be. I'll give you just a quick snapshot that, okay, you're living in the UK, I live in America, we're living in the most top-of-the-line societies. You order something before 5 o'clock and it's on your desk tomorrow morning from Amazon or one of its competitors. You can have anything that you want, really, almost anything. Anything that one might dream of is available in one form or another in London. It's easily available. And just as available in America. Just paying dollars instead of pounds. And I have a student who works for a medical company. I said, what are they working on? You know, just curiosity. They're working on antidepressants because 1 out of 5 Americans is clinically depressed. The other 4 are just depressed. Now why, with all of that, everything available to us, aren't we happy? We ought to be, if that formula is working, we ought to be the happiest people on earth. We should just be like deliriously joyful. But it doesn't work that way. Because we're not just material bodies, and you know, you put something in and you feel good. You know, put a dollar in the coin in the slot. It doesn't work that way. We're spiritual living beings, and no amount of material gratification will satisfy us. It's like putting petrol in your car. It doesn't make you feel powerful. You have to eat. So this body is the external covering of the self. And just trying to please the senses of the body, or satisfy or gratify the senses of the body, doesn't give pleasure to me. It leaves me still hungry. So happiness, as Bhagavad Gita says, is not going to be found just by contact of my senses with material things. And in fact, it's going to go the other way. And I'm going to work real hard for that material enjoyment. And the more I go for it, the more I'm going to make myself miserable. The opposite of what we expect. So the Bhagavad Gita says one has to find happiness within, from one's finding one's spiritual identity, one's eternal identity as a spiritual living being, by realizing that we're not the body, that we're spiritual souls, and ultimately by reviving our connection with the ultimate soul, or the super soul, Krishna, who's the origin of happiness. I mean, let's take it that there's happiness in this world. Whatever you think it is, it's here. Some happiness is here, no? You get it from the sunset, or you get it from family togetherness, or whatever. Where does that come from? It has a source. The sunset has a source, the family has a source, the iPad has a source, which has a source, which has a source. If you come to the original source, you come to Krishna. That's the definition of Krishna, the source of all other sources. That means Krishna is the source of all that happiness that's coming in all those ways. So how much happiness is there in Krishna? He's, by definition, the reservoir of happiness. So if we connect with Krishna, then we're connecting with the origin of happiness and the permanent source. Now I have happiness because my wife is the most beautiful woman in the world and she loves me to death. But that's what she'll do. She'll literally love me till either she dies or I die. And then that's the end of that. But the connection with Krishna is an eternal connection. If we want happiness, we don't want happiness. How much would you like? 5 minutes? 20? You want happiness that's going to last. And how long would you like it to last? Well, permanently would be good. For that, you have to come in touch with the permanent, not with the temporary.
Okay, interesting. I've got a whole range of questions, but if everyone wants to kind of interject and ask their own.
You came with me. Who else is there?
Anyone's got any questions? Okay, we'll carry on.
Do you consider yourself happy?
That was my next question.
Do I consider myself happy? I don't know how to respond. I don't think about it, you know. Am I happy? Yeah, I do. I do. Especially when I compare myself to or compare what I'm getting to what I was getting. When I think about what I thought was happiness and compare that to what I do now, I would not trade. I would not trade. It is happy.
Mm. Anyone else? But then, let's say I'm really
hungry. I get to be happy by writing books about how miserable the world is.
But let's say I'm really hungry, and then my mum cooks me an amazing dinner. There is happiness in that. I do find happiness for once in the food.
Right.
But second of all, it's mum's cooking, right? So it's mum's cooking that I've connected with that person.
Right.
So there is happiness in that. So right. It's undeniable.
Great.
But then how can that be kind of just say everything's just bleak and depressing because...
Well, it depends how you look at it. You got this wonderful meal cooked by your mum, and then the next year your mum got whatever disease it was and hospitalized for 5 years and then she died. That's, and you, all you have of that wonderful meal is the memory of how wonderfully your mom used to cook. So you can look at the bright side and you say, well, live for the moment and all of that, but the moment's going to be over. And if you look at from where am I going to be next? That question deserves to be asked. Just now you're in college because you're thinking that after I get out of college, I'm going to be in such and such job, such and such line of work. You're not here living for the moment. You're thinking about something in the future.
So then if the goal of college, let's say, it's to get wisdom,
Oh, it's certainly not to get wisdom.
Or to get a good job so we can buy things and we can live a nice, comfortable lifestyle.
That sounds more like it.
Then, according to Ecclesiastes, and I'm guessing your view, then is college pointless?
From one point of view...
And we've got the Students' Union here, so...
From one point of view, absolutely. You're being trained to do a job to get some money so that you can have a nice life and die. From that angle of vision, what's the point? You might as well have stayed home. Does it mean I shouldn't go to college? Our point would be, Koheleth really struggles with that sort of question. You know, why then go to college? Why get up in the morning? Why do anything? But from the viewpoint of Bhagavad Gita, things take on meaning or things have meaning when they're connected with the source of meaning. When they're connected with Krishna, things have meaning. When they're disconnected, they're meaningless. Like take my hand. It has meaning. It picks things up, it puts things down, it puts food in my mouth, it does all the things I want it to do. If you cut it off from my body, you can still call it a hand, but it's meaningless, it's useless. Somebody said, oh, no, it's valuable, it's got, it's useless. If it somehow could be reconnected or if it's never disconnected, then it has meaning. So from the Bhagavad Gita's point of view, because we're disconnected from the absolute, because we're disconnected from the whole, our life as parts is spent without purpose. Take the hand of a watch. If you pull it out of the watch, it's just a little stick. It has to be in the watch to mean something. So our life has meaning when it's connected with the absolute, when we as parts are connected with the whole. Otherwise, meaningless, yes. Are we saying that most people are living for nothing? Yeah.
What if you as an individual, if you give yourself purpose, so you say, I'm on this planet for this reason, and while you're engaged in whatever purpose you give in yourself, you're happy.
Yeah, that's who's that Frankl's book, Man's Search for Meaning? That's sort of his thesis, that everybody needs a purpose. And when you live for that purpose, your life has meaning. And what is that purpose? It's whatever you make it. Now, let's examine that for a minute. What makes me happy and what makes me feel like I'm living a meaningful existence? Well, it's exterminating as many Jews in concentration camps as I can, so that the Führer's vision will be fulfilled. That's what gives my life meaning. Now, why is that any worse than your life, where what gives you meaning is feeding hungry orphans in Calcutta? It's arbitrary. Since there's no ultimate meaning, so there's no real meaning, it's whatever I assign as meaningful, whatever a goal I set for myself. Anybody's meaning is as good as anybody else's. Your meaning is to protect, what gives you meaning is to protect the bank, what gives me meaning is to rob it. In computer terms, robbing the bank is 10110011, and safeguarding what's in the bank is 01011001. Why is one string better than another string? It's arbitrary. And I may say, well, this makes me happy and it makes me feel, but it's, in that sense, a kind of arbitrary or illusory or meaningless happiness.
Isn't that good enough?
Excuse me?
Isn't that good enough?
Isn't that good enough?
If the goal of life is to be happy and you find meaning in whatever you're doing and it makes you happy, then...
Yeah, if the goal of life is to be happy and you assign something and when you do that, that makes you happy, that's good enough. But we don't think that's good enough. The animal thinks it's good enough. His goal for the morning is to get some food. He gets some food, he's happy. His goal for the morning is to have some sex. He has some sex, he's happy. His goal is to find a place to sleep. He found it, got some good sleep, he's happy. His goal is to keep off competing animals. He succeeds, he's happy. And we can assign the same goals for ourselves, to have a nice place to live, to have good sex, to eat well, to have a waterbed to sleep on, to have the best damn defense force, and you know, this side of whatever else there might be. And we say, that's, you know, I really feel good. But that's what the animals are getting. And how is our life better than the animal? My happiness and the animal's happiness are the same. I'm drinking wine and the mosquito is drinking blood. I'm sleeping in a hotel and the animal's sleeping in a cave. But it's the same thing. Sleeping is sleeping. Drinking and eating are drinking and eating. Sex is sex. So yeah, I'm happy, you know. This is what I wanted, this is what I got, I feel real good. But I'm a sophisticated animal, that's all.
Okay.
And what's wrong with that? But I got a human form of life with higher intelligence, where I can ask questions about what my purpose is, why I'm here, why I'm suffering, what to do about that. If I don't use that, what a waste. I'm sorry, there was a question over here.
So,
over here.
If you have an absolute hierarchy of happiness, if you were to say that, there's different hierarchies, like there's Maslow's hierarchy, and I've heard there's a hierarchy in the Bhagavad Gita too of the different states of consciousness and happiness. Mm. What evidence do you have that your way of living or your kind of theory of what is the absolute happiness is the right way of living? Because you could ask another monk like the Dalai Lama, you could ask the Pope, you could ask the rabbi, or you could ask different schools of thought, Even you could ask Richard Dawkins, what makes him happy, and they'll give you another absolute. So why is your absolute the absolute?
It's not just sort of arbitrary or, well, this is what makes me happy, or this is my scheme of happiness, but one looks for a deeper understanding of what life is. And there may be competing views of that. We wouldn't say every philosophy is the same. Everybody's really saying the same thing. They're not. Some people are saying the same things. Some people are saying a variation on the same thing. Some people are saying the same thing in different words, and some people are saying something completely different. So it's for us to look at and say, does this make sense? What is, you know, in a legal case, everybody walks in and says something. The judge doesn't say, well, everybody's walking in and saying something. You discriminate. You say, what's the evidence? What's the case? Now, it can be said that the rabbi, the monk, they've opted for understanding something deeper. They've opted for understanding something deeper. So there's a commonality there. They're part of a community, a larger community of people who ask the same questions and arrive at an answer which goes deeper than, kind of get through the day and do what I can and be the best I can be, and those sort of slogans. They're people who go deeper, looking for meaning in life. And that's the subject matter. That's the subject matter for the human being. Now we're in human life. We may go at it differently. We may arrive at different conclusions, different understandings. Now we're in human life. Why am I here? What is the purpose of my life? Why does the world create so much trouble for me? Nobody wants trouble. Everybody wants happiness. Everybody raise their hand. Happiness, yeah. But a secret of the way the world works is that happiness comes automatically. What do you mean, happiness? Evidence is there in Vedic literature. Who wants misery? If I said, line up and put in your pound and we'll deliver misery for you. No one wants it. And yet, automatically, everybody gets it. In some proportion, someone gets more, someone gets less, but misery automatically comes by nature's arrangement. So if misery comes, happiness also comes in some proportion. Why do I have to work so hard for that when it's going to come anyway? The human life is meant for that deeper inquiry, spiritual inquiry. Then we look deeper and say, all right, now that we're in that, where do we go? What makes the most sense? What works? Yes?
One of the sort of descriptions of Krishna is eternity filled with bliss and happiness. Mm-hmm. So if our sort of purpose of the soul is to make Krishna happy, then isn't life meaningless in that sense, because he's always happy and anything we do isn't going to make him any more happy?
Yeah, if the purpose were just to make Krishna happy, it would be useless because he's already happy and doesn't need us to make it happen. It could be better expressed that our purpose is to participate in Krishna's happiness. That is to say, Krishna's already happy, but there's nothing to stop him from becoming more happy. Since his happiness is unlimited, he can become happier. What makes Krishna happy? Your service. Your service, your love, your devotion makes Krishna happy. And then what does Krishna do when he becomes more happy? He wants to give more happiness to you. He reciprocates. It's not just, a tax collector. He just collects it and then you're out of pocket. But because you're coming in touch with Krishna, you're getting happiness. which is your natural happiness, your constitutional happiness, your spiritual happiness. And when the spark is in the fire, the spark is bright. When you're in relationship with Krishna, you participate in Krishna's unlimited happiness. That's a lot better than bleak, isn't it? Yes.
So, to find eternal happiness, you have to be part of Krishna. Do you have to be part of Krishna to find eternal happiness? And how do you do that?
To find eternal happiness, we have to be part of Krishna. Well, first thing is that we're already part of Krishna. Krishna means the complete whole, and we're all parts of however you conceive of the supreme whole. We're all parts already, but we've forgotten our relationship with that supreme whole or with Krishna. So Krishna consciousness means to revive the relationship that's already there. How do you do that? There are various means, especially this chanting. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Is a spiritual sound. And by that sound, our spiritual nature is reawakened. Simple. Simple thing to do. Anyone can do it, and it will be effective. What else can we do? We can hear about Krishna or read about Krishna from books like Bhagavad-Gita, my book, Srimad Bhagavatam. There are many. You can hear about Krishna. You can chant Hare Krishna. You can eat the food that's offered to Krishna. Everyone can do that. That's another way to spiritually advance. There are a lot of things that we can do which are part of the process of bhakti yoga. And those methods of bhakti yoga uncover our spiritual nature. Then, just a question of learning them. Is that all right?
Yeah. So I like to say om and meditate, and I feel like that's the way for me. So different people have different ways, right?
You like to say om to meditate, and that works for you. Yeah. Om is also a transcendental vibration. Pranava sarva vedeshu in the Bhagavad Gita. The om is mentioned several times. The om, Krishna says, is a sound representation of me. So there's no difference between chanting om and chanting Hare Krishna. Except that om indicates an impersonal or vague target. And Krishna is personal. The absolute can be realized in both features, impersonal feature and personal feature. The personal feature is more inclusive. And therefore, we prefer to chant Hare Krishna. It's something like addressing, in our country, the president, Mr. President. That's who he is, his title. But if you say Mr. Obama, that's person. Or Barack, if you're on those kind of terms with him. It's more intimate, it's more personal. It's not just the post. Om indicates the post, the absolute, the supreme, whatever that is. When you come to Krishna, you've become more deep, you've come to a deeper realization of that truth. Is that okay? Good.
I think I just want to take it a step back a little. Because we went directly into, there's this Krishna, we have to serve Krishna to be happy. And there's a lot of assumptions being thrown out there. Mm-hmm. And for me, I think I'm quite skeptical. Because I see that there's this science which goes through a series of experimentation to come to a result. But then there's different faiths which kind of just tell you, do this, do that. you have to do it, otherwise, in a sense, like, you should be God-fearing. Like, the end of Ecclesiastes, it says, oh,
fear God.
The end of this is fear God, and do what God says, otherwise, you know, he's coming for you. Mm. So then...
One commentator said that the view of God in Ecclesiastes is that he's a cosmic bully. Mm. Yes.
Yeah, I can relate. Yeah, I can relate. Mm. But then,
me
how
too.
Does...
I like that remark. That's good.
So then, again, where's the evidence for this? Why should I commit my time to do this when there's so many other things to do?
There's again a question of not just faith, but experience. It's as in science, you do something, you get a result. You do something else, you get a result. It's not just accepted blindly, it's tested. Apart from that, it's philosophically thought out. It's not just believe. You have to believe. Believe or you're going to hell. It's not fanaticism. There's belief. I mean, I paid $500 to Norwegian Airlines and they gave me a number. That's all they gave me. 7 or 8 digits. But I had a reasonable faith that I'd take those 7 or 8 digits to the airport and they'd put me on a plane to London. And they did. So faith is not by nature bad. You know, your mom gives you breakfast, you don't know what's in it.
So what is this experience?
That you have to see. You chant Hare Krishna or read Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says that one who's reading this Bhagavad Gita is realizing me by his intelligence. It's not sentiment. Oh, Krishna is so nice, and he's mine, and he should be yours. Doesn't that make you feel good all over? There's philosophy. Bhagavad Gita is still, after thousands of years, being read. Why? Because there's such a depth of philosophical understanding there. Meditate on it. Consider it. Think it over. Test it.
But I know so many people they've experienced, I've seen kind of good people practicing the philosophy from the Bhagavad Gita, and after 10 or 15 years, you seem to they just like vaporize out from it. And you see people practicing Judaism, and then they seem to kind of go away from it. So there's good and bad in each tradition. So does that mean we have to read everything to work out what's the right way?
You'll spend a lot of time that way. You'll spend a lot of time that way. The vaporizing out has to do with a competition in this world. There's a material attractive force in Sanskrit called Maya, which presents to us the illusion that we're going to be happy here. That you just do all the right things and have a positive outlook and you're really going to be happy. Soon. You know, next step, next step, next step. And that's called illusion. And on the other side, there's truth. There's reality as it is. And there's always a competitive battle. There's always a tension between these two, between truth and illusion. I'm attracted to both. I want to know the truth, but I really want to have a good time because it's Friday night and my friends are all going to the pub. And the pub is all dressed up as like, wow, you're really going to be happy here because all your friends are here and the beer is bubbling. And
so do you have to be exclusive? than to one? Can't you just do both?
Truth and illusion both?
Yeah.
How's that going to work?
So on Friday I go to the pub. On Saturday I
seek the truth, and on Sunday I forget all about it. That's really, you know, in the morning I build up a fire, in the afternoon I pour water on it. That's not really a big fire building exercise. Now in the Upanishads it's said that one should cultivate knowledge and illusion side by side. Vidyamcha, vidyamcha, yes. What does that mean? It means our ordinary knowledge is not going to be given up. I'm not going to say, you know, this is illusion, that this now it's 808. These are just arbitrary numbers, and it's all maya. And what do I need to watch for anyway? And time has no meaning. You know, it's fine. Okay, it's 808, and we're going to go till 810 or whatever it is. So it has value, but it's not ultimate value. It's not that I lived my life and I learned how to tell time. That's not it. You know, I built a building. I invented a new kind of toothpick. That's not, you know, okay, fine. That earns you a livelihood, or that does whatever it's meant to do. But there has to be a deeper purpose. And those smaller things should be connected with the bigger thing. That's the point. And some of those smaller things are just going to be working against me. There are things that I can do that'll drag me down. I want to find the absolute truth and I want to take cocaine at the same time. They're not very compatible. There's some things I should give up if I want to ascend to a higher state of consciousness. And there are things I should accept if I want to ascend. But ascending to a higher state of consciousness doesn't mean I have to give up everything, you know, my clothes, my everything. But it should be connected. There should be a relationship between what I'm doing in this world and what my spiritual purpose in life is.
How do you connect those things?
That's bhakti yoga. That's the science. That's what Bhagavad Gita's teaching us how to do. That's a study, you know, it's like, well, you know, so okay, tell us about trigonometry. Well, it's going to take, you know, a few minutes. But it's there. It's there. If one is serious and one wants to know how to do it, Bhagavad Gita is there. Teachers of Bhagavad Gita is there. Our Krishna consciousness movement is meant for, you know, all right, I read the book, now what do I do with it? Okay, here's how you apply it. Just surgery, if you're studying surgery, there's a book, and then there's their teacher who can show you how to put the needle in and where to cut and how to sew the guy up again. So finding, taking advantage of books like Bhagavad Gita, availing oneself of the presence of teachers who understand the book, and then making it into something practical for yourself. It's not just, yeah, reading Bhagavad Gita. It's something that you can apply in your life. It's science in that sense. In Sanskrit, science is called vigyan, and vigyan also means applied knowledge, applied wisdom. It's not theoretical, you can do it. And gain the ultimate benefit.
Interesting. Do we have any questions from the audience?
Mm-hmm. I was wondering if a person really aspires to sort of reach Krishna or true happiness, would they not follow, say, all faiths and all religions?
How can you follow all faiths and all religions? Can't even think of them all.
Let's say one religion maybe to pray every certain number of times a day.
Those are details. Just like here in England, you may go to Cambridge, you may go to Oxford, you may go here, and each place there will be a different course. But you don't have to say, well, wait a second, over here in Oxford they teach it this way, and over Cambridge they teach it that way. You stick with your course and get it. Not that I have to do everything.
But I mean, if someone really, really aspires to just reach Krishna or God, do they, and they're ready to do anything, you know, they may even have time and effort to go to Cambridge and here and Oxford and anywhere else, if they have the time.
If they have the time, do one. You know, jack of all trades, master of none. The Bhagavad Gita advises to achieve success in our endeavors, focus. Don't try to do everything, try to do one thing well.
How do you choose which one to choose? Which one is best for you? Which religion? What gods can you combine? Or can you just believe in your God with not choosing a religion or faith?
Religion is sort of different from what we mean by bhakti yoga. Religions and faiths you can choose. The Jew becomes a Christian, the Christian becomes a Hindu, the Hindu becomes a Buddhist, the Buddhist becomes a Jain. You know, you adopt a religion. You subscribe to a faith. The idea of the Bhagavad Gita is that there's an intrinsic nature that everyone has. You know, if you attain spiritual perfection, say there's a spiritual world, you're not going to find signposts, Jews this way, Christians that way. Our eternal nature is not that I'm Christian or that I'm Jewish or that I'm Hindu. These are what's called like bodily designations, like I'm American or I'm British or I'm... These are external. That's not my eternal identity. I'm British forever. So I'm not Christian forever, Hindu forever, but what am I? I'm a servant. If you look at your life, you're serving. You're serving your friends. If you're working, you're serving your employer. If you're in business, you're serving your customers. We're serving our, if we have a pet, we serve our pet. There's none of us who says, well, I don't serve. I serve. It's my nature to serve. But now I'm serving my dog, my country, my family, something temporary. But my real nature is to serve the Supreme, to serve God. That's religion. Not Christian, Hindu, Jewish, this, that. In the, there's a book, Srimad Bhagavatam, it's like the postgraduate study of Bhagavad Gita. And there the topic is raised, what's the best religion? What's the highest religion? And the sage who answers says, the highest religion is that by which you develop your svaipum samparo dharma, your eternal connection of service with God, your love for God. Without any motive and without any obstruction. That's the best. Not Christian or Hindu or that means by which you develop your love for God. If you do that here or there, fine. But, you know, like what's the best business? The best business is the one by which you make money. We don't care whether it's selling groceries or cars or whatever it is. If you're rich, you're doing good business. So if you've developed love for God, then your religion is first class. What kind of love? Without any motive. I want this. God, please give me this. I need that. No motive, just to do it. And without any obstruction, under this condition, under that condition. To develop that love is the real process. So if you have some means to do that, then do it. Otherwise, take advantage of this literature, Bhagavad Gita, take advantage of the bhakti yoga process. It's actually for people of every religion. It's not this is for Hindus, or this is for Indians, or this is for anyone. It's like gold. Gold is for everyone. We don't say, well, this is reserved for the Hindus, or this is reserved for the Christians. Or I'm not going to touch that. That's Christian gold. Gold is gold. It has value. So wisdom, knowledge is for everyone. So you can take advantage of these books.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We got any more questions?
For a person who loves God, what do they do? What do they think?
What does a person do who loves God? He serves. He serves. There are different kinds of service, and that's elaborated in Vedic literature. Hearing is service. Just to hear about God is service. To speak about God is service. To remember God is service. There are different kinds, and all of those can be cultivated. This hearing and chanting are especially powerful. Therefore, this Hare Krishna mantra. You're hearing and you're chanting. You're reading Bhagavad Gita, that's service. The whole bhakti yoga process is the process of service. Cultivating, developing that connection of service with God.
Mm-hmm. When you serve people, when mm-hmm. you serve people, you serve your company.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you find that there are more immediate rewards for doing that?
Yeah. If you serve your company, or you serve your girlfriend, or you serve your boss, there's a more immediate reward than by serving God. You know, you serve your company, they give you a paycheck. You serve your girlfriend, she gives you a kiss.
So why would someone choose to serve God?
Because there's two kinds of benefits, immediate benefit and long-term benefit. Your immediate benefit is quick gratification. Your long-term benefit is more valuable. Just like here, you're studying. There's not an immediate benefit. You know, you don't get paid anything. In fact, they take money out of your pocket. But you believe that there's a long-term benefit. After so many years, I'll get a diploma and I'll have skills or knowledge that I can use. Otherwise, every day that you're in school, you could be out there getting immediate benefit. You could get cash in your pocket, or you could be out in the, you know, doing whatever is you think is the most fun. But you sacrifice the immediate benefit for long-term benefit. That's wise.
Another thing. God's less tangible than people.
God is less tangible than people.
If you serve God, you're serving him on faith. If you serve a person, it's not just on faith. You know that this person exists. You know that if you serve them here, it will give you immediate gratification now and in the future. Why would someone opt to serve someone that they don't even know exists, as opposed to someone that they can see and feel?
Why would someone serve someone intangible and unproven and vague, rather than someone immediately here that you know exists and will give you instant reward? It's because they've studied the matter and they're persuaded that God's existence is not theoretical, that God is not just intangible, that God is as immediate, that the experience of serving God is more rewarding than the experience of serving my boss or serving my pet or serving what have you. God's presence is perceivable. How is that? You say, well, I don't see God. I want to see. Vedic literature answers that hearing is more powerful than seeing. Do you see the wind? But you know it's there when you hear it. Hearing is powerful. So the Krishna vibration is identical with Krishna. And by hearing that vibration, one realizes the presence of Krishna. Not just theoretically, factually. Yes?
And why doesn't everyone believe in God?
Because their consciousness is clouded.
People who they're born into a religious family, they would say that they've been serving God all their lives.
Mm-hmm.
But when you were 3 years old, you probably didn't ponder the concept of God or philosophy.
Right.
It was all fed into you.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have these people who, just because they've been, that's how they were brought up, they will never change their ways, which is good, I guess.
Mm-hmm. It's an advantage. Someone is brought up in an atmosphere where there's an understanding of God, that person has an advantage. Just like someone who's brought up in an educated family. He has an advantage. His father is a judge, let's say. One of my friends, his father is a judge. It's an advantage. If you want to get into the legal profession, hey, at the dinner table, they talk case law. Yeah. Now, you don't have to become a lawyer. You could become a car mechanic or a physicist or anything else you want. But if you want to get into law, you have a head start. So a person who's born in a religious family is not under any obligation that for the rest of his life he's going to believe in God or have an understanding of God, but he certainly has an advantage.
And for the people who weren't?
They have a disadvantage. If I'm not born in a judge's family, I can still become a lawyer, but I don't have the same advantage. So I have to become, you know, serious and say, hey, I want to become a lawyer. Well, no one in your family's a lawyer. I don't care, I'm going to become a lawyer. How are you going to do that? I'll go to school, I'll read the books, I'll take the tests. It's open to everyone.
But if you're disadvantaged,
mm-hmm.
and you weren't brought up in a religious family,
mm-hmm.
Isn't it hard? Obviously.
Is it unfair?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, that's a really good question. Life appears, and it's a big theme in Ecclesiastes. It's unfair. One person's born rich, another person's born poor, one person's born sick, one person's born healthy, one person's born in America, another person's born in, you know, whatever the country they're bombing today. Totally unfair. But the Vedic literature says it's a continuation of our previous life. Just like now you're here, it's not that suddenly you are here in City University just by the winds of chance. Hey, you studied, you applied, you paid for your tuition, and now you're here. So someone who's born rich or born poor or born into an educated family or an uneducated family is not there by chance, but because of a previous existence. That's a big topic. But from the point of view of Bhagavad Gita, this one life is not everything. It's part of a long chain, a long succession of lifetimes. So if someone's born in a fortunate circumstance, it's because of activities performed previously. And from that circumstance, whatever it may be, higher or lower, one can make further progress. And that's why ultimate benefit is more important than immediate benefit. Because there's a larger picture and a larger goal.
You try to sway people who weren't from certain backgrounds, for example. If you meet someone who appears to be non-spiritual,
mm-hmm.
and you try to introduce him to spirituality,
mm-hmm.
and it's difficult for you to get any faith into them, they seem to reject it at every opportunity, and they seem like you can't sway them.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a failure on your part? Is it a failure on their part?
Maybe. Our job is to offer. a teacher is not a person who makes people wise. He offers wisdom. Now, people can take it or leave it. That's up to them. In one sense, if you offered it, it's already a success. You did your job.
Wouldn't it frustrate you?
Yeah. But on the other side, I did what I was supposed to do. And the rest is up to him and up to Krishna. It's not that everything's in my control. You know, firefighter, he tries to put out the fire. If he succeeds, good. If he didn't succeed, still he did his job. That's a big part of Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, perform your duty, do what you're supposed to do. And don't be fixed on the outcome. The success is not the outcome. The success is that you did what you were supposed to do, and you did it for the sake of Krishna, or for a higher purpose.
So I think we have just run out of time, but just to end, I know we talked about, and I understood not that much, but we talked about a lot of topics. Quite introspective, quite deep topics. There's a concept in business. I'm reading a book about business, and it's called an elevator pitch. Mm. And you have to pitch something in, let's say, 60 seconds. We have 60 seconds to pitch something. If you can't, it means your idea is too complicated. So for going forward, for all of us, for our benefit, we all want to be successful. How would Vanity Karma, the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna consciousness, in 60 seconds, what can we do? What are the next steps to understand more?
Human life is meant for spiritual realization. Our book rests on that premise, that human life affords us the opportunity to inquire about who we are, about what our purpose in life is, about how to achieve that purpose. And that's our real gain in human life. We can attain all perfection by pursuing that line of inquiry. So Vanity Karma deals with that essential subject matter for every human being, and therefore your next step is to read it.
Thank you.